Welcome to the podcast, Jennifer. How are you doing today?
I'm good, thank you very much.
And tell us about what you do and what are you going to talk to us about today?
Well, what I do is I've spent about the last 25 years developing an intuitive way to understand how people work, and in special reference really to modern society and how that has affected us as human beings. And we can use this intuitive knowledge to improve our lives.
Okay, and how do you do that? Give us more detail.
Well, what I realized years and years ago was that the usual mainstream idea of how people worked, especially in regards to mental health, didn't seem to be truthful in the sense that what tended to happen was that people might improve their mindset, but they still felt quite bad. And so I worked with lots and lots of people, about 2,500 people during this period of time. And depending on the person and depending on their situation and depending on what they were seeing me for, I slowly started to realize that there actually was a pattern with people that we hadn't been taught. And this was all kind of in my head. And about 8 years ago, my situation changed and I decided to write this down. So I wrote two books about it. And then I decided to do videos about that. So I've now got online courses that show people how to learn this, and books that they can use as a reference.
So when you say people were coming to you, were you some kind of therapist?
I wasn't at first. My first job in this was helping people who were working in the Remploy factories. I don't know if you remember Remploy, or even before that, I was working with long-term unemployed people, really to help people to restart their life. So on restart, for example, that everyone was unemployed and they'd have to do these restart courses. I don't know if you remember them.
No, I don't.
In Margaret Thatcher's time. And if you didn't do these courses, your benefit was stopped.
Right.
So every Monday morning, I'd turn up, and I worked for a charity that helped unemployed people. And there'd be about 19 people sitting in a room, really nervous and angry, just doing this so they'd keep their benefit. And so that was my first job, really, in this field. And I found out that by the end of the week, all of them felt better. And then they'd go off and do something else. And that really was the beginning of the journey. So after that, I worked, as I said, in Remploy with people with learning difficulties. And my job there was to find them employment outside of the factories. And then I worked in London on a project to move people on who were something to do with social services in an education or training aspect. And I learned a lot of work there, a lot of information about that there. And then I came to Wales, and then I did community development as a project manager, same sort of thing. And then everything stopped because of a domestic situation I found myself in, and I went self-employed. And I started to realise that when I joined like networks, as you do, and I was actually doing parties, children's parties and things like that, entertaining. And I found that people I was meeting in the business world were more interested in the work I was had done before with people rather than parties. So I started to work very informally with some of them, and they actually started to make more money. So I thought, well, I'm missing a trick here. So I decided to put myself forward as a business coach. And so I met lots of business people and I worked with them, and they found it really, really useful. Not just because they earned more money, but because they could also see where to go forward with their business and they'd have better ideas and more creativity. And a couple of people I met during this phase were spiritual people, and one was a Reiki master, one did acupuncture, another one was a hypnotherapist. And by working with them, I managed to put in the spiritual aspect of us into the model too. And so that really was the end of the development of it. So to answer your question, I was more business coach stroke project manager and community development. But recently, I have used it to help people, not as a therapist, because I'm quite clear that I'm not a therapist. I call myself a trainer or a teacher of a knowledge, really. And it really works for people, especially if they're angry, and especially if they're sort of quite creative or artists. They really understand it very quickly. And what I'm doing now is I'm rolling it out, and I've got 9 people who are therapists or healers or teachers who I now train them in this, so they can use it as part of their toolkit when they work with their own clients. So now I'm training the therapists and the healers.
Right. And so give me an example. Like, say I'm a business person, or say I'm somebody who's got some kind of problem, and I come to you. Like, how does it work? Is it conversational, or what do you do with people?
Well, it depends on their situation. I've developed the online courses. The online courses and the books work really well with the therapists and the healers and the teachers, because they are coming to me with a certain knowledge already. So they can pick it up quite easily from the online courses and the books. And I do talk to them on Skype as well, and I build up a relationship with them. Because what's happening is that the who you are aspect of yourself is something that I look at from a very practical and pragmatic type of way. So I get to know who they are as well at the same time as training them, because what we're going to do, we're going to start doing this now, is we're setting up a website between all of us. So the more people who learn this, then we can come out together with a website, and they're all talking about their area of experience as well. So one of them teaches karate, he's a black belt in karate. Another lady is a hula hoop teacher. Another one does firewalking, you know?
Right.
So given their who they are, they all use this knowledge in their work, in their way, to take it forward in that sense. So it will be a place for people to come, no matter what their situation and no matter what their actual particular thing is that they need to look at. And then they can meet these other people with that experience as well, you know, because it's okay having a knowledge, but you also need to be able to apply it. And unless you work with someone who understands where you are and you understand where they are, it can be quite difficult. So the next phase of this is to get the practitioners, and I call them respected professionals. They're people who are respected professionals in their own right, but who also use this model to enhance the service that they offer.
I'm trying to think of what I can relate it to. Is it like life coaching? Is it a series of questions? Like, how do people do it? Do they sit down in a chair? Do you talk to them, or is it like energy healing?
I see what you mean. It's something that they learn, a bit like maths. So imagine it's a bit like teaching someone maths. So if they want to talk to you on Skype, and you can see them, then I can do that. If they like to study at home using videos, then they can do the online courses. If they want a personal touch, you know, you can actually see the person. So I'll give you an easy example. So if there was a young person who was depressed, maybe at college, then I would probably suggest that they speak to the energy dynamic model practitioner called Evie Jacob, who works with, she is a young person herself. She's gone through similar things herself. She does hula hooping. So she would probably use the hula hoop in order to teach the person the principles of the energy dynamic model, you know? And she would do that given their learning style and what they wanted. So you can teach it in any way, really.
Okay, but okay, how does it work, though? I'm just trying to understand it.
Okay, so I'll tell you about the actual idea, shall I?
Yeah, yeah.
The actual concept. The concept is that human beings are basically at the most fundamental level of where they work, the most fundamental way that you experience this life on this planet is from an energetic place. And this energetic place that you operate from is where you get your information from. So the basic equation is you experience life given the energy dynamic you're in, and I'll talk about that in a minute, and the information you're getting, okay?
Mm.
Now, there are three different ways to engage with your energy dynamics, how you are engaging. And those three ways are the spiritual way, the mind way, and the feel way. And the example I use is, if you imagine a house, there's a house. If you're on the ground floor, in the kitchen, in the garden, what you're experiencing is actual feel. So you're experiencing life in the moment, doing things and feeling. So if I'm cooking, I'm actually physically cutting up the carrots and I'm eating them. My children are there. I'm giving them a hug. You know, I'm not thinking. I'm just doing and being. So that's the ground floor. Now, if people are experiencing life from the ground floor, that's actually how humans are supposed to be. That's how we were as cavemen. We were just doing and being and caring and loving, whatever. Now, in this society, that's really, really difficult to do. And a lot of people who live in this energy dynamic feel quite bad because they're not getting enough energy, because it's very, very hard to generate this sort of energy unless you're conscious of it. Okay, so that's what I call the feel dynamic.
So if we're in our body and we're present and we're doing stuff like kinesthetic sort of activities and stuff,
yeah.
And so you're saying that gives us energy, is that what you mean?
It gives us a feel energy, and it's a plus or a minus. So if I'm giving you a hug, I get a plus feel. And if you're hitting me with a stick, I get a minus feel.
Right. Okay.
Okay. So that's the first way of getting energy and information. And the information you're getting is from your activity. Okay. It's a direct one.
Right.
Now, most people, however, are on the first floor of the house, and that's where the bedroom is. Okay, and they're looking at what's happening through the windows.
Yeah.
And this is what I call the mind dynamic. Now, the mind dynamic is where emotion, you experience it as an emotional thing, and it's a process, and you will be looking at it from a process point of view. So you won't actually be experiencing it in the moment as a feel. You'll be thinking about it and looking at it from the first window as a process. Now, I say that this energy is very much like fire. The feel energy is very much like water, and the feel energy you actually store in what I call your goldfish bowl of feelings, which is around your stomach area, which is very much in line with sort of Eastern ideas of your solar plexus. Yeah.
Mm.
So if you are having lots of good feels, you will be building up what I call like sparkling water in your feelings, in your goldfish bowl of feelings. And if you're having sad feels, that would be like dark water, a bit like Coca-Cola or something. And often what happens is that as people experience sad feelings, then they're put into bottles, and these bottles are stored in your goldfish bowl of feelings, and that's where your sad energy lives. And if it stays there for a long time, it turns into bad energy, which we'll talk about in a minute. So that's back into the feel there.
Yeah, I see. So is it, that's a way of visualizing and compartmentalizing feelings.
Yeah, it's intuitive. Intuitive way to, yeah.
So we're saying the feelings and the bowl of feelings is on the first floor. Is that where you're putting it, or was that on the ground floor with the experience?
They're on the ground floor, yes. Yeah, sorry,
oh, right.
I skipped there. I went up
okay,
and down.
Okay, so the goldfish bowl of feelings are on the ground floor with the experiential things.
Yeah.
And then the first floor is like the mind stories that we're running.
Yes, the mind stories, yes. And it's there's lots of different levels to this, so I'm just giving you a very basic one, okay?
Mm.
But on the mind, on the first floor of the mind, that's where we think. Now, lots of people have left their ground floor and they've gone into their mind. They've literally gone into their mind. And they're living their life and their experience, their life as a process. So they are thinking. And this does give you an energy. And this energy is like fire. So it's where goals live. It's where targets live. It's where thoughts live.
Yeah.
And so if I'm running on that sort of energy, which most people do, it's where your status in society lives. So if I'm living off mind energy, I need mind energy every day. So I need to hit my target. I need to have my nice car. I need to have my nice house. I need to have approval. I need to do my role well, you know, and I need people. So basically you're getting energy from that point of view. You're getting energy from other people's approval.
Yeah.
So It's I call it a tick or a gold star. Okay, so that's the first floor, and people often live up there. Okay, and then the next level is on the roof, and the roof is the spiritual level. Now, this is very similar in essence to feel, but there's a big difference. Because it's on the roof, you're then observing life. So the ground floor, you're experiencing life. The first floor, you're processing life. And then on the roof, you're observing it from a spiritual place where there's no time, no space. And most people go up there through meditation or prayer. They actually go up, they leave the ground floor, and they just go up there. But they obviously do get energy from that, and they also get information from that, as people do when they meditate or when they pray. And then they come down again. But that energy, you kind of basically go up there to get some energy, and then you go down again, but you don't bring it down with you. And that's another long story. So people kind of pop up and escape from the ground, and then they go down after they've had a bit of a rest, and they carry on. But they normally go back into the first floor, actually. They don't normally go back into the ground.
Right.
So there's three different ways of getting energy. And if you assume you need 10 units a day,
yep.
What we really need to do is we really need to get about 6 at least from feel, and then maybe 2 from mind, and then maybe 2 from spirit. But most people don't do that. They normally get about 2 from their feel, about 2. Then they get about 7 from their mind, and they probably get 1 from spirit. And this causes huge problems. I could go to the next level of understanding now if you want.
Sure.
You can ask me any questions.
Well, I was just going to say, yeah, that makes sense. I see what you're saying. Yeah, people, there's something sort of grounding about being present in the moment, doing experiential activities and stuff.
And it's also where who you are lives on the ground floor, and it's also where love lives. There's what I call power needs. And you gather up power needs, and that's what your brain uses to work out how you feel. So there's 4 types, and one, for example, is love and care. Another is health, are you in pain or not? Another one is safety, are you safe? So that's, for example, 3 of the animal power needs, which is the ground floor.
Okay.
Now, basically, the brain knows that it needs certain amounts of energy to live. Now, this is really interesting because the reason that we need energy to live is because we're living on this planet of time and matter. You know, there's matter and there's time and there's space. So it's quite low. It's quite hard to get through the time. And that's what we need energy for. That's why when we meditate and we go up into the spirit, we don't need much energy because we're not in time and space. So in order to actually manifest our who we are, we need energy to get through the time and space. So if we don't have enough energy, our brain will say, right, this isn't working, we're not getting enough feel energy, mind, take over. Because the mind can take over, and the mind can get energy, and it's a higher vibration. It's lower than spirit, but it's higher than feel. And this mind energy is another source that human beings can use to get through time and space and deal with matter, yeah?
Right, so we get energy from these levels. So you're saying by engaging in the mind level, we get energy from that, and we get energy from the ground floor level. But you're saying that there's problems if we get too much from the mind level and not enough from the other levels.
Yeah. So basically, we're very interesting creatures because we can get energy from 2 different sources. The feel, which is a low vibration, and if you go into it all, it's probably the same vibration as Schumann, I think his name is, the resonance, the natural rhythm of the world, the earth. It's that level, it's a low level, whereas mind energy is on a higher vibration, and it's very much, it's just where emotion, negative emotion is fueled from your bottles of feels that you're stored, okay, but positive emotion is from approval, as I said, and it's like a fire, but it doesn't last very long. So you need another one, then you need another one, and then you need another one.
Right.
And it's quite addictive because you always need more because you're not getting any feel energy. Because feel energy, because it's like water, you can carry it with you and it lasts quite a long time.
Right.
You know? And you're constantly generating it, because if I'm cooking a meal for you, then I'm cooking, then I'm feeding you, then, and I'm giving you love, you're giving me love back. So we're generating this feel that I can take with me all the time. Yeah, it's used up by getting through time, but it's in essence, it's water. It's quite quiet and it's contentment. You know, it's that strong feeling of being. You know, whereas mind energy is relative. Mind energy doesn't last very long at all. So if I get a paycheck and get some money, I'm like, yes, I've got some money. I then spend it and I need some more money. Then I need some more money. So and if someone gives you an approval, and goals are a classic here. If you set me a goal and I achieve it, what do? You give me a higher one, then a higher one, and then a higher one, because I need a higher one, because it's relative. Whereas the feel energy is absolute. You know, if I love my child, I love my child. I don't have to love them more every day.
So it's like the feel energy is like slow coals burning, and then the mind energy is like fast burning, like paraffin. It's gone really quick.
Yeah, it's like I use when I'm teaching this and on the videos, I use fire. Literally, I use a candle and I light it, and that's fire. Bang, you can blow it out and it's gone. Whereas the feel is water. It's like water. It's quite quiet. It's quite cooling. It's quite strong. You know, it's always there. Water is there, whereas fire is temporary.
I see,
And
yeah.
as you said, it needs fuel. It needs fuel. You know, whereas water doesn't. And the reason that water doesn't need fuel is because it's based on who you are, and you're always who you are. And that, going into the spiritual aspects of it all, is the information that you've been given is in your form and your essence. Sorry, in your essence when you were born. You the information, and I break this down again into very practical things. One of them is your talents, one of them is what you prefer, one of them is your learning style, one of them is what you're good at, you know. So you've always got that, and that's how your brain works out what you feel. So you don't need an outside source to actually understand what that is. You need an environment to express that in, but you're always it. So you'll always carry your feels with you, because you're always who you are. Whereas as soon as you go into your mind, it's totally based on an outside measurement.
I had this exact experience that you're describing. About 10 years ago, I used to do a lot of internet kind of work. I was
Yeah.
building websites and doing internet marketing. I was just sat at my desk a lot of the time, and I wasn't really very happy doing that. But then what happened was I started getting into exercise and stuff, and I got into my
Oh,
body and out of my head a lot more. So I started doing a lot of physical activities. Like I started with weightlifting, and I started doing yoga, and I did other stuff. And I had the experience of, getting into my body a lot more. And I was a lot more happy in
Yeah,
myself.
more content. Yeah, you're more content. Yeah, absolutely. Good. Yeah, so that's it. So that's the feel, and then there's the mind. Now, what happens is, so the brain will tell the mind to take over if you don't have enough feels, basically. And then, again, another way of putting it is that your mind starts to control you. And that's where the word mind control comes from, because your mind is controlling you. There is obviously another way of understanding mind control, but let's assume that we're talking about it. So your mind is controlling you. So you are making your decisions based on what your mind is saying, based on your first floor, based on what everyone else is saying. Okay, so your life becomes not one that's in line with who you are at all. So you then become even it beca it then becomes even harder to get a good feel, because you're on the first floor and might have a role that is not in line with who you are. So if I who I am loves flowers, but my role is working in Tesco's, I'm not going to be getting any good feels from being who I am, for example.
I see.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you can find a role that's in line with who you are, you get a good feel, and you get what I call a tick, a gold star. Now, this becomes quite magic eventually, because remember I was saying that you have to go up into the spirit as well to get that. So by definition, if you do prayer or meditation, you have to shut your eyes, shut your senses off, and go up, don't you? By definition. Now, if you're aware of this idea, and if you're aware of your feels, and if you're aware of ticks and mind energy and vibrations and all that, what you can do is you can start to create a world that is in line with who you are, in the kind and humble way. I talk about that a lot, the kind and humble way, and by doing lots of love and care to yourself and to things around you, etc. Now, what happens then is that your brain realizes that you're getting good feelings in. So your brain tells your mind, hold on a minute, you don't have to run me anymore, because the person is getting enough feels themselves. So the mind stops running you. And as soon as the mind stops running you, you then go into the ground floor.
Yeah.
So you can then, this is why it's really good for creative people and for artists and entrepreneurs, actually, because then you can suddenly see what's going on as you're experiencing it, rather than, for example, going into your mind and having a plan and sticking to your plan, never mind what's going on in the present, which, again, by definition means you miss loads of opportunities because you're too busy sticking to your plan.
Mm.
Yeah. So what happens is, once you start to build up more feels, and say you're getting 5 or 6 now from your feels, and you're only getting a couple from your mind, you experience a big shift in your actual, what I would call your energy dynamic, but actually it's your experience of life. And what you can then do is, instead of going up into the spirit to meditate and spread, what you can do, you can actually bring the spirit down into your life. Because, again, we're assuming that part of us, we are actually all part of one huge big thing, you know, one big consciousness, and we are mere elements of that. So if I am doing my who I am, so say I like cooking, if I then bring that into my actual reality and actually start to cook, actually show a bit of love around cooking and actually start to share the love about that, then we actually start to experience our spiritual mission or purpose or whatever you want to call it, as an ongoing real world episode, rather than having to stop our life and shut it off and go up and get our spiritual energy. We can actually bring it down with us in our everyday life. And that is really the beginnings of manifesting your sort of ideas and creativity. And that's when you start to actually change your environment. That's when you actually start to change the world around you, because you're starting to manifest your who you are and bringing down that spiritual kind of idea.
Right.
Actually physically into the space and time that it can't get into unless you bring it down into your life yourself.
Right.
You can't do it unless, because you're human. You need to be able to have a high, good feel for it.
So we're creating an integration between the spiritual level and the,
yes,
the what do you call it? What's the ground floor level called?
Feel. So the feel level, the feel who you are level, the feel. Yes. In fact, you've got it. What this idea does is it looks at your environment, it looks at your feel and who you are, it looks at your mind dynamic, and it looks at your spirit, and it separates them all initially so you can understand them all. And then once you understand them all, you can then put them into a line so you experience that as a whole person. Whereas normally most people are very separate, you know, then either in their mind or then they nip off for a bit of spirit and then they, I don't know, they might have a bath for a bit of feel. And it's all very, it's almost like a triangle. They're going from one zone to another, then to another, then to another. And it's quite endless. And a lot of people get feel from other people. A lot of people get feel from escape worlds, and that's drinks, drugs and all that. Other people is abuse and that sort of thing. So they kind of go in a triangular shape from spirit to mind to feel, then to an escape world, and then up again and then down again. Whereas if you understand this and you can know your spirit, know your mind, know your who you are and your feel, and know your environment, you can then put them all together so they're in one line, and then they all become one whole, as in W-H-O-L-E.
That does make sense. I feel like my life is very integrated. I never feel like I enjoy what I do. I never feel like I need to escape or go and get away from it. I never feel like I need to go on holiday.
That's right.
I'm self-contented. I enjoy what I do. It fills me up and it's all one thing.
Yeah.
I don't really have much separation between work and other areas of life. It's just one thing for me.
That's right. Yeah, good. Well, that's great. And I have a little funny. I've got a little language so people can use a language to understand this. And I say that, as I said, the water, the field is a plus or a minus, a good or a sad, you know, a sad, a sad or a content. And then the mind is the fire, is the tick, is the gold star. But if you manage to be whole, as you said, you get a plus feel and a gold star at the same time. And when you get that gold star at the same time, that's called a frilly, because it's an extra, it's a bonus, it's a frilly. And if we can engineer our life so we're scoring a frilly, so I'm being who I am in a kind and humble way, feeling good, and you're paying me money for it, that's a frilly, rather than cutting off your who you are, cutting off what you feel in order just to achieve a tick of money.
Yes, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I've never been of the belief, a lot of people believe you've got to choose between either your passion or making money, and it's like one or the other, you know, and it's always a compromise between the two. I've never believed that. I've always believed you can make money doing what you enjoy.
Of course you can. Of course you can. And that's it. It's you're spot on. And that's the separation, isn't it? That's the separation. People are taught in the mainstream. It's like, as I said, I've written one book about this from more of a society point of view, which is what we're talking about, really. And then I've written another book on actual practical how to understand these steps, you know, like I say it's like the highway code. If you understand what a no entry sign looks like, if you understand how to go round and roundabout, then you can drive your car easily because you understand the mechanics of the highway code. And the second book I've written is the highway code, really, of how we work as energetic human beings in modern society. And if you understand that, you can then work on what you've done is to create a life which is in line with who you are. So you're feeling good, you're showing love, you're still being a human being. And you could then make money by accident, basically, because you put yourself in a position where people value you. And because one of the ways we are taught to value things in this modern day society is to pay you money, you'll then get it. But the mainstream teaches you, no, cut off from what you feel, cut off from your family, cut off from, you know, put your children in childcare, send your kids to school, you know, you've got to have a career, you've got to be successful. And the only way you can do that is to cut off from your feels. That's what you're taught. And that's why mental health has gone through the roof. And the even worse thing that's happening now, which is just again a development of the thing, of the topic, is the AI and the computers. And if you think of approval and money and status as a fire, you know, energy, the computer is almost next to that. And I say that's like a solar panel. So you've kind of like got a solar panel on your head, yeah, which is giving you energy all the time. And it's like recycling it, because you're on a computer, you're on Facebook, you're getting likes, and it's feeding you with energy, and you're getting that from the computer.
Yeah.
So, and that's why if you take that solar panel off someone and they're used to it and they're a child, they go absolutely, they have a meltdown because they haven't got enough energy. They don't know where they're getting their information from, and they panic because their brain thinks, oh my goodness, what's happened? We've just lost 50% of our solar panel energy because the computer's turned off.
Yeah.
You know?
It reminds me of people that play a lot of computer games or something.
Yeah. It's really scary stuff. And that's not only separation from ground floor, first floor, but that's actually like going into your next door neighbour's house, you know?
Yeah,
it's like
right.
Going into your next door neighbour's first floor. And getting energy from that. And the brain, you see, because the brain is just looking for energy, you know, if it works, that will become your norm. So if you then take it off you, you will then kick off. And that's why children, you know, have got such bad, you know, emotional anger problems if you take them off an iPad.
Yeah, right. It's an addiction, really, isn't it? It's an addiction to whatever the fast-paced stimulus. Yeah.
Yes, it's the energy and the information. And people look to that to give them energy and information. That's what they're looking for now. They're not looking for their, I don't know, partner or the fire in the garden or whatever to give them feelings and energy, you know, energy and information. Like, they're looking from a computer to give them information and energy, because that's our basic fundamental bottom line what we need. Because if we're not getting information, we can't compute what's happening.
Yeah.
And that's another reason why, if you take off the computer of someone, this happens to me a lot because I don't have a smartphone. I don't use Google Maps. And I've got children and one of them's got a football match, I say to someone, how'd you get there? They say, Google it. And I'm like, well, no, I'm not going to Google it. I want to find out. I want to get a map and I want to get there by myself using my own skill.
Mm.
Yeah. And that's why people are becoming so dependent on computers, because that's where they're getting all their information from. So you take that away, they don't know what to do.
So I think what you're saying is, it's not that we shouldn't go to these different things and get information and energy from these different places, but it's a case of getting the ratio right so that it's sort of healthy.
It's a bonus. So, yeah, exactly.
So, like, for example, if someone spends 90% of their time on Facebook and getting their energy and information from a smartphone, it's not that you shouldn't use the phone at all, but it's like we need to be getting most of our energy from the fields
absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, otherwise, our mind will take us over. And if our mind takes us over, we've lost where who we live is, and we've lost where love lives. That's where love lives. And this is why, again, going to AI, this is even further on now. We're going deeper into the rabbit hole here. If everyone is mind-controlled, if everyone is using their mind to make rational decisions, there is no place for love in that. Love doesn't live there. It's just a processor. It's a processor, your mind, okay?
Yeah.
So if you're making rational decisions based on that, you're not computing love. You're not computing empathy. You're not computing compassion. And that's where our human essence is special. That's where we get the spiritual download too. So, again, the phrase, if you don't use it, you lose it. If you're always working from your mind perspective, not only do you not have any empathy or any love or any care because it doesn't live there, it's not because you're a nasty person, it's just because it doesn't live in your mind. That's not where it lives.
Right.
You know what lives in your mind is success and achievement and more and more and more and role and approval, because that's that type of energy. It's that's that wavelength. That's what it picks up. That's what it computes.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the more people are becoming mind controlled and using their mind to get that energy, and also the other extension of going into their next door neighbor's house with a solar panel and getting it from the computer, you're not getting it from love. You're not getting it from your own experience, and you're not getting it from your own personal knowledge. And that personal experience and knowledge and love and care, I call that, that's the glue that connects people. That's the glue that keeps people together. That's the glue that makes you strong as a society, you know? And if that glue is not there, if that connection isn't there, then we're just all basically like robots. We are like mind-controlled robots, because that's not where who you are lives, and that's not where love lives.
Yes, that makes total sense. Yes, it's very fundamental to our nature and our need to. We've got a natural need to be in community and connected with others in a real way. And and the more that we get our energy from other places, we're detaching ourselves in a very fundamental way from our nature, aren't we?
Yeah, we are. And that has huge consequences for the spiritual as well, because it means the spiritual can't come down into our life. So, I mean, the classic example, this is a classic example, is the, you know, the busy person going to work 9 to 5, then going to yoga, to meditate, to then go home to have a glass of wine, to then go on a computer and go to sleep.
Yeah, they're doing a pit stop around each thing.
Yeah, they do the triangle.
Right. So it's like fragmented, but they're stopping off at each one to fill up at each one, rather than it all being
that's
integrated.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's why they feel empty. They feel empty because they're not filling up with good feels.
Yes.
Yeah,
I see.
And that makes you weak. That makes you... I mean, some people, sadly, they feel that, and so they decide to get their good feelings from other people, and that's where abuse comes into it. That's where I might feel really empty, and I'm going to go and target you because you make me feel good. And then if you leave me, I'm going to make you stay with me. I'm going to control you because I need your good feelings. I need your attention. I need the information I'm getting from you to allow me to experience my life, because I can't experience it myself, because I don't know who I am, because I have no identity, unless it's through you. And that's why people stay in bad situations, because it gives them an experience of life. And if you take that bad experience away from them, they panic because they're full of dark feelings. They're full of sad feelings. And their brain says, we can't deal with this. Go into the mind, get some tics. Oh, no, you can't succeed. You're rubbish. So what do? We go and take drugs.
Right. So that's like a codependency situation, is it?
Yeah. So you can kind of use this idea. Yeah, you can use this idea to kind of understand any kind of situation that you're going in through. And what I found is that by just understanding this idea, it can improve someone's life 50%. I was working with someone in January, actually, who was angry. And within 1 week, he'd stopped feeling angry because he could see it.
Yes.
He could just see it. Then people can then work, and this is where the therapists come in. So if I can teach therapists to use this as part of their framework, so it's like, well, this is how we work, let's all understand this, and then this therapist is really good at, I don't know, Reiki or something, you know, then they can use that in order to help the person feel better and then to start to create a better world for themselves, you know. So the second step is to apply that to yourself, you know, and then people tend to feel about 25% better because, again, they're shifting. And then once they get the hang of that, then what happens as well to your sad bottles of feelings that you have stored in your stomach area, what happens is as your feelings go up, if you imagine your sparkling goldfish bowl of water fills up, the brain then allows those bottles of dark feelings to empty. So you actually start to feel lighter because your grief is emptying. And then what happens, and this is fantastic, and I must talk about the imagination in a minute because it's really key. So once your goldfish bowl of feelings starts to empty your grief, not only do you become less emotional because you're carrying less dark energy with you, but also you can stay in the present more because you're not busy being emotional.
Right.
So the person experiences what is known in the therapy world as a healing crisis. So they kind of feel really good. Then their bottles of grief are empty a little bit, so they feel a bit sad. But then their mind clears, their bottle settles again, and then they do the next step. And then by the time they've done this about four times, that's when they actually start to change their environment, and that's when they may change their job. It's when they may decide to move. It's when they may, you know, they actually make a direct decision to improve their life.
Yes, yeah. I was just going to ask, could you give us an example of the ways in which people have changed their life as a result of this work?
Yeah, well, hugely. Every single person who's understood this, it's changed them to a degree. But I think that's because it's based on observation. It's not a theory, you know. It's not saying I sort of dreamt upstairs in my bedroom one day, you know. It was based on what I saw working.
Mm.
So, for example, with the angry chap, because he realised he had some sad feels, he was carrying sad feelings, and he saw it as a goldfish bowl, he saw it as a bottle, he started to see it. Once you become conscious of it, it's got much less power over you.
Yeah.
And you can see your own patterns. I look at people's patterns because that's the information that they've got. So they're carrying old patterns of information because they're still carrying the grief, or they're carrying the contentment as well. So we look at the patterns. So this chap, for example, realized in order to not be angry about this certain thing, he just had to change his environment because he could see that his bottle of grief was going to fizz up, which would make him angry. That's, again, how we talk about it. It's like your bottle of grief is going to fizz, rather than saying anger, which is just like an emotional word, which doesn't mean anything.
Right.
If you can visualize the process that you go through, you suddenly understand what's happening to you. And that's not the case with a lot of people. They don't understand why they stress. They don't understand. They might think, oh, it's because I'm on the computer too much. Oh, it's, you know, always because I've got an issue. But it's not. It's because they've got low power. They've got low goldfish bowl of feeling. It's too low, so they need to build that up. Mm-hmm. And the way they do that is by knowing who they are.
I changed my environment recently. I used to live in Bristol until a couple of months ago. I decided to move to Newport because I think it's like you just said, I recognized that my environment was kind of triggering and sort of causing, what, how did you put it? Cause your grief to fizz?
Fizzy, a bottle to fizz up. Yeah, it goes into your mind and then your mind takes over, you get very angry or anxious. Anxious is the other one, yeah.
That was happening to me
Yeah.
all the time. So I moved city, I moved to Newport.
Great. Great. Yeah, so it's like they said, it's like the highway code of how we work as human beings. So it depends on what the person's situation's in to how it changes their life, but it always changes it in the way that they want to change it, you know? And so yeah, and I kind of do, but sometimes I do work with families as well, with children as well sometimes. But so it, yeah, it just teaches them. It's, I mean, I can give you examples, but it just depends really on the person. My personal interest is really now in training the therapist to use this model, so they can use it to get it out there. I just wanted to get it out there really, because I think it's really, really helpful in this modern day, because people are just getting brainwashed and mind controlled, and they're doing it. They're doing it to themselves, and they don't know they are. And then they wonder why they feel bad.
So let's imagine there's a therapist listening to this who's interested in learning or training. How does that work? How do they come to you or what?
They just, yeah, they come to me. They go to my website, which is www.energydynamicmodel.com, and just have a look, see if you like it. I've got lots of interviews on there as well. I've done quite a few interviews, and then they contact me, and then I'll chat to them, and then they can do the courses, and you can get trained to a basic level for under £200, and you pay bit by bit. So it's not like you, it's not a lot of money, you know. It's not like NLP where you pay thousands. It's just enough to just turn me over, if you know what I mean. I mean, I do part-time work in care to keep myself going, you know. I do cleaning, you know. I do I because I because to me the most important thing is to get this out there, because it really worries me as to how the world is going, and I really want this information to be in the hands of people, you know, normal people who can suddenly see what's happening to them. And to go back into the imagination, if that's all right. But this is so important, because your imagination, okay, your imagination is part of who you are, and that lives, that's supposed to live in your field. It's how we imagine things. It's how we have empathy. It's how we create. It's what makes us a human. Okay. Now, most of the time, our imagination is not in our fields. Most of the time, our imagination is in our mind, because the mind takes your imagination over when the brain tells it to take over because of lack of energy. And what the mind does to your imagination is it uses your imagination to time travel into the future, to time travel into the past. Yeah? So that's why people worry. That's why people have flashbacks. All sorts of things happen, and it's a bit of a long story. But it's normally in the mind. And the real problem about that is that not only can you not use it as a human being for empathy purposes and creative purposes, but also it's also the doorway through which the spirit comes through. You use your imagination when you meditate. You use your imagination when you pray. You use your imagination to go up. But the mind uses imagination to go into the past or the future. So the mind uses it in a linear way. With the mind, if you have one and you plus another one, you make 11. Okay, you get two of the same thing. That's how the mind works. And if it has the imagination, you'll be everywhere except in the present by the mind. Okay,
I see. So
yeah,
let me
it's where
just.
you hear.
Oh, I was just going
Yeah,
to
go on.
check if I understand what you mean. So, if you're using your imagination sort of from your embodiment level and you're using it
Yeah.
as a sort of access to the spiritual level, that's kind of what we want. But if you're using your imagination at the mind level, then you're going to be like
Yeah.
worrying about the future or like, what's it called? Grieving over the past or something like that.
That's right, and it doesn't change anything. You just get more of the same thing. So, you know, if I work for you pay me £10, I work with you for an hour. That's what's happened. It's an equal exchange, but nothing bigger has happened. It's just I've paid you ten, you've paid me £10, and I've worked for you for an hour. So 1 and 1 is 11. It's just we just get lots of things. Yeah. Yeah. Whereas in the feel level with the imagination, 1 and 1 makes 2. So I meet you, you meet me, we have similar who you are's, we have an idea and that idea becomes manifested, and that's bigger than either of us.
Yeah.
That's the magic. That's human alchemy.
Did you say that was the mind level?
Sorry, that's the magic. That's the magic. This is the feel level. It's where I have an idea. Yeah. And we meet each other on the basis of who we are, what we know, and what we know is good. And then as you know, as a sort of creative sort of type person, things just take on their own form, don't they? Ideas just develop and grow, and just because we've sat in the room and done something, you know?
Yeah, when both people are authentically being who they are, and then they collaborate
absolutely
from that place, that's very powerful then, isn't it?
That's it, and that's that low vibration, that's that low feel vibration of who you are, and your imagination's there, and it's magic, it's alchemy, it's one and one makes two, and two is a different thing than two ones, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah? It's like, you know, in leadership, they talk about breaking a glass ceiling, that the mind is the glass ceiling, and all you can do in the mind is get better at it. You can just, I can just get better at making money, okay? But I won't develop anything. You know, in the field, the imagination can change the whole environment.
Yeah.
You know, it changes the whole environment, changes the game. Whereas in the mind, you just get better at playing the game. Whereas in the field, the game stops because you find something bigger.
I see. Yeah. There's like at the mind level, there's just like a linear progress.
Yeah.
But at the field level, it's like it's how to say it. Yeah. You're creating a whole new thing. It's like a quantum shift sort of thing.
It is exactly quantum shift. It is a quantum shift. You're on the quantum level, which is again another. You can get into all that using this as well. You can get into the quantum.
Yeah.
Probably, but yeah, and on that quantum level, actually, that's how the spirit comes down. That's how the spirit comes down, because you're on the same vibration. Right. How did I describe it the other day? I described it. I know how I described it. Imagine music. Yeah.
Yeah.
Imagine the feel is middle C, okay?
Mm.
If you go up an octave to top C, it's the same information, they're both Cs, but the top C is the spirit and middle C is you.
Yeah.
But they're on different vibrations.
Yes. Yeah, I see. It's in harmony with who you really are, but it's at a higher sort of level of refinement or something like that.
Yeah, and the reason that it needs humans to do this is because humans can exist in the vibration of middle C.
Right.
Whereas spirit can't, because spirit's too high. It's got too high a vibration. It can't get through time and space.
Yeah.
Okay. So the more you develop middle C, the more you can download the information from top C.
Right, I see. Yeah, there's like a balance between the two. Like, you've got to be grounded and present in this physical realm in order to receive
via your imagination. Which is also probably where your the gland in your brain. I can never pronounce it. The pituitary gland.
Yeah.
It's probably that. I don't know that, but it's probably that. Because again, I talk about this in an intuitive way.
Because there are people, like you said, people that are just sort of sat on the roof. They're kind of spending a lot of their time in the meditation realm. And it's like they're not really manifesting it or creating
anything
in the world because they're not on the ground. Yeah.
That's right. And I know it's always baffled me. That always baffled me. I've got nothing against meditation. And I think it's actually very, very good for you. And I should do it more. But it doesn't replace your feel.
Yeah.
It must not replace your feel. And the beautiful thing is, Ben, the beautiful thing is that, right, there's a project I'm going to start. My personal interest is with drug addicts and abuse. That's my personal interest. I like working with people like that.
Mm.
And I'm going to start a project up, which I can tell you about that in a minute. But basically, by me doing that project and me putting love and care into it and me engaging in it, that is my meditation. That is my, I'm actually bringing that, I'm treating it as a meditation, if you get me.
Yeah.
Just by doing these things, like serving and caring and, you know?
Yeah, it's got a higher purpose.
Yes, and that's how you bring it down. That's how you bring it down into this earth. Whereas what happens when you meditate is you go up, and you go up, which is great. which is great, and it's good for you, and it keeps your brain and imagination in the right place. Okay, it's not mind, which is the most important thing.
Yeah.
Okay, because once you're stuck in mind, it's very hard to get it out. I mean, that's again what I can do, or what a practitioner can do who's using this model. They can help people to bring their imagination down again, you know.
Yeah.
But when you meditate and you go up with it, at least it's using your imagination in a good way, you know, and at least it's giving your brain a break because you are getting a good energy. So I'm not for a minute saying it's bad for a minute, because it's not, it's good. But it can't come down into this planet unless you have good enough feels to bring it down. And if you're kind of spending all your time on the roof, what are you here for?
Yeah, exactly. So you it's know? Like,
what are you here for?
Yeah, yeah, I agree. So it's like, it's better than just being in the mind and stuck in that loop.
Yeah.
But then it's better again if you can bring it down and manifest it.
Yeah. You could say that's our purpose as human beings. We are doorways for that spirit to come down through.
Yeah.
And you could say it's almost a spiritual battle, because meanwhile, what with the AI or the computers, they're bringing down information as well. Okay. And in a way, and again, this is a little bit, a few more steps here. The fact that people are starting to give their consciousness to the computer is really alarming. It's really alarming, because that's where they're giving their consciousness. They're not giving it to humanity in a love and caring way, bringing down the spiritual download of the C or the D or the E or whatever it is, you know. So by putting our consciousness into the computers, and it's not quite that bad yet, but you know, 10 years time we'll be uploading ourselves, you know. We've now lost ourselves. We are now no longer, we're now in our next door neighbor's house. We're not attached to ourselves, we're not attached to a spirit, and love has gone.
Yeah, it's very interesting. The more we invest our attention and put our creativity goes into Facebook and goes into the computer screen,
yeah.
And it's almost like to some degree we're starting to exist in that realm and not in our body. I mean,
you are, and that could be seen as satanic.
It's like we're getting disembodied in a way.
Yeah, because love doesn't live there. Our humanness is in our humanness.
Yeah.
It's not in that.
Yeah.
It's not in that. And the way you access the computer is you access it through your mind. And that's the problem. Well, not the problem, one of many problems. But you're having to go into that vibration, that mind vibration, in order to access it. You have to. Okay? And when they start to put things in people's brains, that's where they'll put it. You know?
Yeah.
In that bit. It's not through love. It's not the love bit.
Yeah, so it doesn't matter how cool and clever and cutting edge it is. Like you say, love doesn't live there.
And love doesn't live there, yeah. And who you are doesn't live there.
So the project, you mentioned drug addicts.
Oh, right, Right. Well, one of the ways that I teach this is by using things I make, and I've made something called a power tower. And a power tower is a wooden thing where it's like a stick that represents who you are, and it's got little carvings on it. So with the letter P on it, 'cause it's your preferences, letter T, which is your talent, so you can remember who you are. And then on this stick, I put the power needs, and they're like big circles with holes in them. So you put them, you make a tower. So you've got 10 of them, and they get smaller. So what my idea is that I want to sell these power towers to people, to the therapists, to people who are interested, to people who want to support the project as well, to anyone who wants to understand how people work. And it's almost a conceptual art version of how people are as regards feel.
Mm.
Okay, so it's a conceptual art piece, really, but I use it to teach people. So what my idea is that I make these, and I've got a couple of workshops in my back garden, and I make them there. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite people to come along, and they can volunteer, and anyone can come, but it will have particular benefit probably to someone who's maybe trying to recover from some sort of trauma or abuse or whatever, because it will give them something to do. you know, and to come along and to, and we'll teach them how to make a power tower. Not the whole thing. We'll start off just by doing a little bit of painting or something. But by them doing that, they'll be doing something. They'll meet other people. I will teach them this informally because they'll learn it because they're making it.
Mm.
And as they're making it, they're turning their sad energy into a good energy, which means that's going into the power tower as they're making it, as a manifesting it. Mm. Yeah. And then I'll fund this project by sending the power towers.
Right. I see. So they get to learn this concept by going through the process of sort of creating this thing.
Power tower.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. And they'll feel better because they'll be somewhere with people being kind to them and they can talk and they'll make friends, etc. Might do a bit of gardening, you know, whatever.
Yeah, right. So you're getting them into their bodies, into the fields.
Yeah.
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 And so I didn't quite understand. So they make it in such a way where it represents like...
Yeah, so the thing is called a power tower that I designed it. I've actually got intellectual property rights on it. Through whatever, so I'm going to sell these to people. I'm going to sell them to people, okay, whoever they may be, and but the people who come in the Power Tower project are going to make them. They're going to make them,
right?
And but the first step is just to paint them because they're different colours. You could do different colours and stuff like that. Mm. My son, who's an artist, he is using the jigsaw and the wood and making making the structure. But the people just need to paint it.
I see, yeah. And is this, can you take this into, like, schools and stuff, or do people come to you?
Yeah.
Right.
I could do, well, as I said, I'm literally just starting it,
mm.
literally. I've got some interest from an organisation that I won't name because it's not decided on it definitely yet, but it works. Basically, I suppose I've tried to, again, mind-wise, I've ticked lots of boxes because I need to make myself be able to spend more time doing this work. So if I sell power towers, that'd be great. I've got the energy dynamic model, respective professionals using the model, and they can use the power tower as well as part of their toolkit. So if I get people on board who are learning this, who are therapists, then they can also buy a power tower, which will enhance their service. But also by working with people with the drug problems and that sort of thing, I'm providing a service for them that they would probably not be able to afford if I charged them for it.
Mm.
So it's free for them.
Mm.
So they can come along and be taught this informally and be around other people and just get better and understand how they are. I mean, I'm thinking of doing this alongside other agencies as well, because this is only one aspect of it. I can provide the training and the skills and the painting and the get better bit, you know, the initial bit. But depending on whichever agency they're dealing with, they can then take them to the next steps, given who they are and what they need next, you know.
Yeah.
So it's like the first step. It's like the very first step of someone who thinks, hold on a minute, I don't like how I feel. I want to change my life. How do I do it? And they can come here and learn how they work. And once they learn how they work, they will then have the right information to go and then find the next agency who will then support them in that.
Yeah, sounds great. Are there dates booked already? Like, how can people find out how to come along?
Well, just go on my website, really. Go on my website or contact me. If you go on my website, my contact details are there, and they can just contact me and we'll arrange it. I'm looking to start it on probably a Tuesday and a Thursday. And they obviously will have to live in South Wales.
Yeah. Also, I was going to ask you, what about the books as well?
Yeah, the books you can buy from my website. I've just recently taken them off Amazon.
Okay.
So you can buy the books off my website, and there's a shop on my website, and you can also buy a power tower off my website, although they're not actually on there yet.
Right, right.
But you'll be able to buy the books and the power tower from my website.
Okay.
And the website we're setting up with the energy dynamic model respective professionals is going to be up and running hopefully in a couple of weeks, and that website will all be about information. So we're all going to write blogs, and as I said, we're all from different. We've all got different areas of speciality, and so people can go onto this website and read the blogs, find out more. And then if they want to work with a particular person, then they just click on their photo and then they'll be taken to their website. But what they've all got in common is they're all using the energy dynamic model as a tool, as part of their toolkit. And so we're all knowing what we're talking about. We all understand the language of the energy, the vibration and the feels and the mind and everything.
Yeah.
So that's, we're all working from that point, yeah.
So that's the new website would be like a hub of the trainers that have been trained to facilitate this. Yeah.
And that website is www.stress-ed.org.
Okay.
So it's a bit of a play on words there, stress ed.
Great. And is there any other projects that you want to mention?
No, that's more.
Yeah, that's enough.
Training the therapist and doing the power tower is really my end point, if you get me. That's my end point.
Yeah.
I do videos. I've got a YouTube channel and everything, you know.
Okay.
That's energy dynamic model. I'm going to do a talk on love today. I do one about once a week.
Great. Okay. So
on YouTube.
If you wouldn't mind doing me a favor, and when we finish the conversation, if you send me all the links, like your current website, the new website, the YouTube channel, I'll make sure I put them all on the podcast description.
Oh, that'd be great. Thanks.
Yeah. Well, that was very interesting. It made sense. I could see how that, you know, related to other things I'd learned in other ways. I could see the parallels. You know, you found a way of, what do you call it? Yeah. Like using the house as a metaphor to sort of, excuse me. to explain, you know, the kind of balance we need in our life. And yeah, I think that made a lot of sense.
Yeah, good. I'm glad you enjoyed.
Yeah. Thank you, Jennifer. Well, unless you've got any other final comments, I think we'll wrap up there.
Yeah, well, not really, except to say I think it's a really important time, and it's really important to keep being human. Because if we don't, you know, it could be quite a sort of a bad situation in you know, for some years to come. And what I'd really like to say is that everyone can make a huge difference. I don't think people realise how much difference they can make. Everyone can make a huge difference, and just by doing their who they are and feeling good and the kind and humble and bringing down a spirit, you can affect hundreds of people's lives. You know, just by doing that in your own environment, because of the effect that you like that with one person and they carry that to another person and they carry that. And that's what we need to be aware of, because that is also how, for example, the internet works. You know, it's a grid of stuff, and we need to realize that we can do that too, you know, but we don't have to do it through that medium. We can do it anyway through our natural glue and our natural vibration with each other.
Yes, perfectly said. That definitely resonates with me.
Yeah, so I think it's so important, and I think everyone needs to just know that and do it, and then we can change the world in a day, you know?
Mm.
Because you have so much power. You know, if you don't like something, don't do it.
Yeah.
You know, don't do it. Don't give your attention to it. Don't give your focus. Don't give it. In the book, in the second book, I wrote an extra chapter a couple of years ago, to say that you can sum up everything really in this one equation, which is focus equals energy and information. You know, sorry, not your focus. Experience equals energy and information. Your experience of life will be exactly what you put into your information, what you gather up, and what vibration of energy you get it from. You know, and you can change that just by what you focus on.
Yes.
You know, and it doesn't have to be mental mind focus. It's just doing focus.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense.
And then everything could change really quick. But I don't think people realize that. I think they think they have to do the mind stuff. They have to get up in the morning and do their job and do that. They don't have to do that. That we all need money. Yes, we all need money. But we can earn money as a frilly. We can earn money given who we are in a kind of humble way and creating good feels.
Yeah,
because it's just a bit of paper. We can. There's nothing wrong with money, but we need to do it so we get a good feel at the same time.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
and I think if people understood that, they would then realize they don't have to be trapped in the role they're playing because they think they should.
Yeah, yeah, I completely agree. Perfectly clear, perfectly said. Thank you so much.
Okay, well, thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, take care, and I'll send you the links once I've uploaded this online.
Great, thanks very much.
All right, Jennifer, bye-bye.
Thank you, bye-bye.